it's a great day in the kingdom of God, and I'll tell you what, I am usually excited about these programs that we're doing. I use different names. They're a conference call, but now that we move to a video format, I'm calling them call webinars, but when I talk about it, it's a show. And I think it's a prophetic insight, because I believe God's going to actually have us develop some media shows. But whatever this is, it is exciting. And what you're going to hear on this particular program, there's another word, program, but what you're going to hear is just so exciting, exciting to me, and I'm confident it's going to be exciting and encouraging to you. We've been doing these for a long time, and this particular program, show, has generated more feedback to our office than anything ever. So what's happening here, we're doing two basic things, really. Normally I teach, and I had a planned message for tonight, for this program, and what happened is usually the first 15 minutes of the program is dedicated to what I call prophetic insights. And occasionally I have somebody else come in besides we kind of call them in-house prophetic specialist, Chuck Witzel. And so I asked somebody else to do the show tonight, because she is heading up the state of Maryland's April 9th program in Washington, D.C. Now, I don't want to say too much here, because you're going to hear it, but this lady, Joyce Ruani, is incredibly prophetic. I've known her for a number of years, and you'll get a little insight on this here. But a couple years ago, literally, God had her, sent her to the West Coast, and had her step into the ocean and made a decree about a move of God that is happening right now. And in the specific words that she said was that it would be a move going from coast to coast, from east to west, or west to east, whatever it was. But April 9th of this year, now I know some of you are going to be watching this after April 9th, because that's how it works. For years to come, Jesus Terry, people are still going to be watching this. But I'm telling you, prophetically, April 9th, 2016, something is going to happen in the spiritual realm that's going to affect the rest of life as you and I know it. A motion in the realm of the spirit. And what's happening is on the West Coast, Luengo is bringing together his call. And simultaneously on the East Coast, Washington, D.C., totally unrelated, not planned, but on the same date, and you're going to hear in the program here tonight why this date is significant, but without any planning of each other, a call to repentance in the capital. And I'm going to leave it at that, and you're going to hear incredible prophetic insight tonight. So what I did is I had Joyce take Chuck's spot for the first 15 minutes, but earlier in the day, in talking to Chuck, and he was part of leading a prayer intercessor group, and God gave him just this incredible word about a kairos moment, where we are right now prophetically, and how God is moving in raising up or bringing together the Josephs of the world. And it's just a very exciting time. I really believe we're at this appointed time where God is going to demonstrate his power unlike anything we've ever seen. And I've been calling it an awakening, but when I was in Germany a few weeks ago, I recognized it's more than an awakening. It's a move of the heart of the Father in a coming together of the body of Christ. And I've been going more into that, because God's just been, in the last month, downloading to me insight about this. But in any event, so the first half of the program today is going to be Joyce Ruani. And then, ironically, she was calling while she was traveling on a mission trip to Alabama from Washington, D.C. area, and we lost her. So in the last couple of minutes of her conversation, we lost her. So, but it was just a perfect ending point. So we transitioned right into Chuck Witzel and the word that God gave him that day. And I promise you, it's going to bless you. Now, at the end of the show, as I'm sharing about this kairos moment that is so incredible that we're in, I made a little blooper, and I knew I was making it kind of because I wasn't prepared to talk about it. But see, as we're coming up to appointed times, appointed seasons, with Passover, and then the first fruits, which is the resurrection, and then, you know, 50 days later, we have Pentecost. These are appointed times, just like the season we're in right now, an appointed time. Well, in any event, in all of that, talking about that, I gave an example prophetically from Genesis relative to Noah's account of when the ark rested, and I wasn't prepared. I'm just flying out of my heart, speaking I do so often, just out of the abundance of my heart, but I didn't have the exact scripture reference and the detail exactly right. So I want to make two corrections here. First on that, and then I made a special offer at the end that I missed. I called it the wrong name. So let me give you these two corrections real quickly. First, let me just read the scripture to you in Genesis chapter 8, because this is a prophetic word about the coming of Jesus and the resurrection. It's just so amazing. 1 Peter chapter 3, I think it's about verse number 12, somewhere around there. But it talks about Noah's ark and that whole deal being a type and shadow of sort to the resurrection of Jesus and salvation through him. And what we see is that prophesied in the ark of Noah. And here, let me read this to you so I can give it to you exactly right. In Genesis 8, verse number 4, it says, "The ark rested in the seventh month on the 17th day of the month upon the mountains of Ararat." Now here's what's interesting. You know, first off, why would God put a detail like this? I mean, who really cares what day, you know, the ark came to rest? What difference would it make? Seventh month, 17th day? Anyway, so here's the inside scoop. That in Jewish days, in the time of Genesis, they celebrated their new year in the fall of the year in the month of Tishri. That was, you know, the first month of their year. Now, when Passover came, God reorchestrated their calendar, and they went from a civic calendar, to a religious calendar. So now, when God initiated Passover, he said the first month of the year will be the month of Nisan. So that is basically April. And we look at what happened in the Passover story and how Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem Palm Sunday. And then 3 days later, he was examined. And literally at that point, then Passover came. And that's what happens. They examine the Passover lamb. Well, he was found to be no fault with him. That's what Pilate said. And then Jesus was crucified on Passover. Now, I know this messes up a lot of Easter stories, but really, Jesus was crucified on Thursday, not Friday. And the Bible says that he spent 3 days in the grave. Now, according to the laws of God gave of the Passover celebration, the Passover lamb was always sacrificed on Passover. Well, God said Passover is the 14th of Nisan. So that means Jesus was crucified on that exact day. So while the Jews were celebrating the Passover one end of the town, killing the lambs, Jesus, as the Lamb of God, died on Passover on the cross for you and I. But that was on the 14th of Nisan. 3 days later is the Feast of First Fruits. That's when Jesus rose from the dead. Well, what day is that? That is the 17th of Nisan. So now we look at this Genesis account. It makes a lot more sense because God prophesied in Genesis 4 the day of the resurrection. What day was that? The seventh month, which from the calendar of that time would have been the month of Nisan and the 17th day. How incredible is that? That God here, I mean, literally 4,000 years, roughly 3,000 some odd years prior to, predicted the exact day that Jesus would be raised from the dead. Hallelujah, a new beginning. Well, praise God. Now, I want to make one other quick correction. I'll come back to this at the end, but you're going to hear me share about a revelation that God gave me, and anyone that makes a contribution and makes a mention of this is going to receive this revelation free of charge. This is something you hear about. I'm not going to be redundant here. You hear me talk about it, but I identify the title of it as I Am Anointed. Well, that is the concept of it, but the actual CD is called, or set, I should say, it's two CDs, is a revelation of the operation of the anointing. And the key to that revelation is that you are anointed. And the confession is, I am anointed. Well, you're anointed by God to do great things in the kingdom of God. And this is the season we're going to see that fulfilled. And when you hear the background to this, woo, you're going to want it. Well, how can you get it? Well, you can go to the library, you can order it, or make a donation. And just on your donation memo line online, you can just say, I'm anointed, or revelation of the operation of the anointing, and we'll get you this set absolutely free, because we appreciate and thank you for your support of the ministry. So let's go and hear about this incredible two-part show, program, webinar, whatever. It's good. Hallelujah. Let's go. We are now in the real mode here. We're recording, and I just want to thank every one of you that's on the call here, giving us the opportunity to speak into your life. We're honored, we're privileged to have you take time out on a Tuesday night. As many as we have on the call here right now, we probably have 2-3 times that many that are going to listen to the recording here over the next week, and then be posted on YouTube here. We're catching up on our YouTube, by the way. Got 2 videos posted this week, and hopefully we're going to get 2 more, and hopefully by next week we're going to be caught up, so we're current. But I want to just say thank you to everybody as well for your prayers and for your financial support. God has just been stretching our borders. And this last week, Friday, I was actually asked by Dr. Rivers to represent I Change Nations as his statesman, to represent him in the nation of Grenada. And they've already made the appointment, and the minister down there, the guy's actually running for president of Grenada, has accepted that appointment. And I'm going to be going down there probably in the next couple of months and speaking on behalf of I Change Nations to the leading youth of the nation, as well as some churches, religious organizations, as they refer to them. And then also speaking to the president of the country. At least that's the plan, or what they're saying is going to happen. So we'll see. But it's your support that makes this kind of stuff possible. And the good news is they pay for all my expenses, and I get a diplomatic ambassador's welcome as we fly into the country to represent Change Nations. But you know, as far as receiving offerings and stuff like that, when we go on these kind of trips, it is a missionary outreach. So your prayers and your financial help certainly help us to stretch ourselves as we are. Also, we're believing God for finances to continue to develop technology to do all that God's given us to do, to see over 100 million people saved, discipled, and serving God. So a very special thank you for your partnership with us in the ministry. Well, tonight is going to be a little different than usual. Typically, I take the first 15 minutes of the call, webinar as it is now, and we give that portion to what we call prophetic insight. And usually we have Chuck Witzel or somebody in the prophetic arena share with us for the 15 minutes, first 15 minutes of the program. And so for this week, I asked Joyce Rueni to share with us. And you might remember she was with us, almost about a year ago, sharing with us about dream interpretation. And I've known Joyce, I guess for a couple of years, been a partner to the ministry, tremendous woman of God. Joyce, are you here with us right now?
I am here.
Hello. I am. So I don't want to embarrass you too bad, but...
I'm so excited about your appointment to Grenada, because that was pretty much the kickoff of our meeting together and this connection with Dr. Rivers. So I'm so excited that this relationship that you two have garnered after that initial meeting has just taken off.
It's all your fault.
God is just doing amazing things with that divine appointment. And, you know, I told Dr. Rivers when I met him that day that you know, it wasn't just going to be one nation of Burundi. And so now it really warms my heart to see that it blossoms into another country in Grenada. And this is just the beginning. So
it
I'm very
is.
Excited. Yeah.
It's been great. It's been made clear to me that this is the beginning of a many-nation tour, if you will. But praise God. Well, you know, it's a kind of interesting story, and Dr. Rivers even talks about it. Because for those that are listening here, of course, I put Joyce's picture up on there. That was when she graduated from high school 100 years ago. Actually, that's, you said about 3 years ago when you were attending some...
Yes, when I was in ministry school, Global School of Supernatural Ministry. That's actually at my daughter's graduation, David.
Okay. Well, never. You look good, Joyce. I mean,
thanks.
So everyone can see your smiling face right now, too. But anyway, it was about a year and a half ago, Dr. Rivers was speaking in, was that Hershey, Pennsylvania or something, right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
At a conference.
To Restore America.
And the way he tells the story, this wild woman came up and grabbed him by the lapel and said, "You got to meet somebody."
Yeah, it was a great day. The whole encounter was just such a divine appointment. And I'm just so happy and so thrilled that it's all worked out, you know, to give glory to God. It's just amazing.
It is, and that's the key there, to the glory of God. I mean, it has just been amazing what God has done and what he is doing and where he is taking this. And, you know, I really believe it's going to be a key to the 100 million souls saved, discipled, and serving God. So, anyway, Joyce, you're spearheading something in Washington, D.C. That's kind of an extended event that's happening on April 9th with Lou Engels in L.A. Why don't you tell us, because you're more aware of it than I am, tell us first what's going on in L.A. and then bring it from the West Coast to the East Coast.
Okay, great. On April the 9th, Lou Engel is hosting a call, and our friend there on the line from California, I was so excited that someone from California called in, because Lou Engel will be on the West Coast, and he'll be hosting a call with, you know, thousands and thousands of people all at once, repenting and praying for our nation. And at that time, on the same time, on the same day, on the East Coast, and these two events were not intended to be related.
Oh, really?
The way that, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought it was planned. No.
Absolutely not, no. So on the East Coast, Lewis and Rachel Hogan, Lewis got a vision from God and was given direction to hold this prayer gathering in Washington, D.C. on April 9th to pray and repent for America. And it was later then that the two discovered, wait a minute, Lou Engel's doing this on the West Coast. We're doing this on the East Coast. So it's a marvelous occurrence of events that's happening at the same time. And then, as God would have it, 2 years ago, I was in L.A. at a Lou Engel event with an itinerant minister friend of mine. And we felt pressed to go to put our feet in the Pacific Ocean. And what we did 2 years ago in February, we started praying and making these proclamations and calling on God to call revival from sea to shining sea are the words that we used when we were praying, and for a revolution to come to America. And so 2 weeks ago, I talked to my itinerant minister friend and asked where she was because I wanted her to come to Washington. And she was like, "Joyce, I'm headed to the West Coast, to Lou Engel, because I'm praying at the call on April 9th. And I was just like, "You've got to be kidding me, because I'm going to be on the East Coast." So here, at one point 2 years ago, we were both standing with our feet in the Pacific Ocean praying to God for a revival from sea to shining sea, and now she's on the West Coast, and I'll be on the East Coast on April 9th. So this is just an amazing series of events.
And that is.
And then April 9th as well is the anniversary of the Azusa Street Revival.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually also the ending date of the Civil War. The Civil War ended at Appomattox Courthouse on April the 9th. And it also marks the day that Dietrich Bonhoeffer was martyred for standing in his faith and believing what he believed. So the date is very significant, and it was given to Lewis Hogan by God. As he prayed and pressed God, well, what do you want me to do? You know, after he saw this vision, and he heard Washington, D.C., and he got this date of April 9th for the nation, for the leaders of the nation, for pastors and leaders of churches to come to Washington, D.C. to pray and repent for our nation. So there are lots of folks right now that the group is in a 40-day fast. We're on day 22 on March 22nd. But this 22-day fast, a 40-day fast that's leading up to the April 9th event. And there are many great people that are standing behind Lewis Hogan. Jonathan Kahn has joined the group, Bobby Schuller, Larry Tomczak, and Graham Lotz, Alameda King, Matt Lockett, Doug Stringer, and I'm sure that I'm going to leave out folks, George Wood, Harry Jackson Jr. There's some pretty significant folks that are rooted and grounded in God that are going to be standing in Washington, D.C., praying for our nation, praying repentance. So I'm so excited, and I'm very hopeful that at the same time, while these prayers are being shaken out on the East Coast, they're going to be shaken out on the West Coast.
Absolutely.
And this repentance is going to meet in the middle, as we had talked about earlier. So I don't know. I say Midwest, look out.
Yay.
Because the two have to culminate in the middle. So I'm very excited, and I'm very hopeful. And, you know, the theme of this April 9th event is a Joel 2 moment, you know, that we're to call a sacred assembly and gather the people and sanctify the congregation and assemble the elders and pray for the nation. So that, and in Washington, D.C. in particular, our nation's capital, it's significant that leaders are going to gather there and pray, because it affects what happens in D.C., affects the entire nation.
Yeah.
So it's significant that leaders, catch the fire of this repentance and prayer, and that prayer returns to the nation, and that we, ask God to repair this covenant that we've let go. We haven't held up our end of it, because our founding fathers, they founded our great nation on prayer. And it's so fallen to the side. And I just see this movement of 24/7 prayer coming back to our nation.
Yes.
And I believe, God's word says that when we humble ourselves and pray, he will hear from heaven. So I'm hopeful. God's word is true, and he never falters. So I'm very hopeful, and I'm very thankful for this opportunity. And my role in this is the Maryland state coordinator, and there are actually state coordinators for every state on the United States on the East Coast, east of the Mississippi. There are people that are mobilizing pastors and church leaders and church congregations to come to Washington. And every significant event that's occurred in Washington, a prayerful event, enacted some form of change and some change in the culture. So I'm hopeful and I'm prayerful that this will do the same, that we're going to have a culture shift, and that we're going to turn back as a nation and stand in unity and stand for God and stand on the founding principles, what we founded this nation on, what our forefathers founded our nation on. So that's my hope and my prayer for April 9th, and I'm hoping that you all will stand with me and tell folks about it, and gather as many people in as we can in Washington to just pray as one group of people.
Do you know, is there any kind of a simulcast plan for that? I'm sure there must be. God TV or somebody must be.
I understand that we're going to be streaming in Lou Engel's call into the event on our side on the East Coast at portions. I don't know how set in stone that is. And I don't know that it's going to be a webcast. My part in this is to mobilize folks to come and pray. So I really don't know a lot of the particulars about what's going to actually take place at that time. I do know that leading up to this and in the planning stages of this, there have been upper room gatherings that have been led by South African evangelist, and he's a missionary to the United States, Andre Van Ziel. And his meetings have turned into being these upper room gatherings. Like, leaders will just be weeping and and crying out to God in repentance. Mm. So it has been common that in every place that Andre has been in the last several months, that this is what's happened in these upper room meetings. And there will be an upper room meeting just prior to this event on the 9th. And if you need more information on that, I can send it to you, David, and you might have it available for folks in regard to the upper room meeting in Washington.
Yep, we can do something with that.
So, that'd be great. Thank you
just heard him speak last Sunday, wasn't it? Like 2 days ago.
I saw Andre in Virginia Beach. We did a filming at CBN Studios with Pat Robertson, and Lewis Hogan was interviewed there. So I was with the whole crew of state mobilizers and coordinators in Virginia Beach just a couple of weeks ago. Yeah. We had a very powerful, prayerful meeting. It was just very exciting. And the momentum just seems to be building and building. And I know, and I can tell by the list of supporters that we started out with has grown exponentially. So, I just know that God is up to something, because when you're calling people out in the numbers that they are responding to this call, it's just amazing, you know, to know that they're hearing the same thing, and that we're sharing a unified voice, and that they're willing to lay down their lives for that day to pray for our nation.
That is awesome. Is it like an all-day event, like morning to night or afternoon?
It's from 9 in the morning until 4 in the afternoon, and it'll be at the Lincoln Memorial.
Okay.
So
then, I mean, quite probably, I mean, someone like God TV might be carrying it. We'll have to look into that to see if that might be available for people.
Yeah, I'll have to find out if I have any more information on that. I can share that with you.
Well, that very day, I'm going to be in Milwaukee, so right dab in the middle of the East and the West coming together. And
that's what I'm saying, David. Look, you're just positioned. I'm so excited.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting that, I mean, prophetically 2 years ago that, I mean, you called it into being. You're a dangerous woman.
I'm not going to take credit for that. I'm going to let the Holy Spirit have the credit all for that, because, you know, when you get directed to these places, and I had no intention initially of going to the West Coast, didn't have the means, didn't have any of it. That's a whole long story in itself. And my trip was funded by someone, and I was able to make it to the West Coast, and there was no intention of me going to put my feet in the waters of the Pacific Ocean. And it just all, you know, God just leads you to these places, and it's just like you just walk step by step in obedience and just open your mouth, and the stuff that comes out. Because when Seed of Shining Sea came out of my mouth, it even surprised me. And I was like, and then when I was talking about, when I'm praying out revolution, I'm thinking, oh no, I'm a law-abiding citizen. Why am I calling revolution? But I just let it go, because, you know, and I thought about it afterwards, because revolution is so much more than overturning a government. And if you think about it, it's a complete circle as well, like a revolution of a circle. So from the beginning and going back to the start once again. And that's where I see it going, is that we're going to go back to the beginning and go back to where we were called from and be recreated into the nation that we were called to be and that we started out to be. One nation under God is what we started out to be.
Amen.
And we've come, it seems, so far from that. And so I believe that we're given that opportunity, and we will be given that opportunity through prayer and fasting and heartfelt repentance to go back to that beginning.
Yes.
And reestablish that covenant once again.
Yeah, so I'm really confident, spiritually really confident, God is raising up not a new America, but the America that he planned. And I just really believe we're going to see, I guess revolution would be a good word for it, but doesn't mean the government's going to be overthrown, but it means there's going to be a change. And in the hearts, just imagine what would happen if, I mean, incredible events started happening on April 9th in Washington, D.C., and people started getting filled with the Holy Spirit in the halls of the Congress, and you know, just people just radically transformed and touched. I mean, I can see where God can do something pretty incredible on April 9th and beyond. You know, and what a revolution that would be, that all of our senators and all of our congressmen started repenting. Woo!
Amen. And I think that you were so privileged when you were in Germany to see a part of that.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, you know, your testimony of those meetings in Germany was just a little foretaste of what could be when you saw love break out with these people and the Holy
yes.
Spirit break out over that group, that such a large group of people all at one time. I really believe that you've been given a foretaste of this, what's coming.
Well,
I'm so excited and so hopeful about it.
Well, and this is, as I was just remembering as you were saying that, while I was in Germany, you were in Mexico.
Yes.
And that was pretty amazing trip you had down there a month ago, I guess it'd be.
It was, yes, a month ago. We were in opposite places, but in Mexico it was a similar experience for me, is that the Holy Spirit was just so prevalent in the meetings, and that many people were baptized in the Holy Spirit. And it was just in large numbers, you know. And you would think, in my mind, I would think, like in some of these places, that people that are going to church continuously or you know, have been faithful members of a church would have already been baptized in the Holy Spirit. But it seemed like it's this new renewal that's coming, where a baptism of the Holy Spirit and people weeping and you know, praying out in a heavenly language. And it's just all so spontaneous. And it's so overwhelming that, and I, we've talked about this before, is that, you know, people are saying they're at the altar by the hundreds. And I'm like, if it was, I didn't realize it, because I was so caught up in praying for people and so caught up in what was going on with the Holy Spirit that I didn't realize that I was in a sea of people,
mm-hmm.
all at one time being baptized in the Spirit. It was an amazing experience.
Well, and the story you're told about people coming in and what's going on, and one by one as they came in, they got a dose of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, it was just really awesome. It was a great time.
Well, Joyce, God certainly is using you. I mean, people that on the call here probably have no idea of the magnitude of the uniqueness of your ministry, and I know it's a humble servant ministry, but, I mean, just wasn't it last year you went to Rwanda and Burundi and Kenya?
I did. Actually, I was in Uganda, and I had a beautiful trip in Uganda and a similar experience with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and people, like we were in a remote sort of, I don't want to say jungle place, but it kind of was a tabernacle, you know, up in the far reaches of the jungle. And this group of people there, they were just baptized in the Holy Spirit. As soon as, you know, I was given the authority by the person that I was with to release the Holy Spirit, and as soon as the words came out, the Holy Spirit was prevalent. People were weeping, and they were praying in tongues, and it was just a mighty, mighty move of God. And even mm-hmm. At the border of the Congo, there was a large group of pastors that were gathered that wanted to come to this meeting. And even there, that group of pastors were baptized in the Holy Spirit. And it was just such a thickness and a presence of God in the place. And it was so reassuring to me and just such an encouragement that it was right there on the border of the Congo. And so I just know that something is coming to the Congo, because these men had traveled to get across the border to get to this little meeting house that we were gathering in. So it was so, you know, just encouraging and heartwarming to see. People in this particular village, it was like a refugee village. There was a particular lady there that had so much faith that she checked herself out of the hospital to come receive prayer at this meeting. And I was blessed. The woman was in my line, in my prayer line. I was so blessed. She came to me and she told me that she had checked out of the hospital because she knew that God was going to heal her in this meeting. And so I prayed for the lady, and she walked away saying that she was healed and wasn't going back to the hospital. I mean, that's faith that, you know, we can't even grapple with.
Yep.
You know, that you're going to check yourself out of the hospital.
Well, that was a prophetic journey as well. I mean, everywhere you go seems to be, you know, a prophetic calling. I remember being with you, it was a year ago, January or December, in Florida, in Orlando, and how God just directed you and flow around the city, and that was a real supernatural occurrence.
Yes, Yes, it was an amazing time as well. And shortly thereafter, I noticed that there were many revivals with some of the ministers that I had been following, and they were having like an increase in their participation at the meetings, and they're making announcements. We're in revival. You know, we don't want to just be in revival. We want the revelation, right?
Yeah.
And we want the revolution, and we want a change, and we want it a lifestyle. We don't want it to be a week long, a 2 week long, a 3 week long. No. I'm praying for it to be a lifestyle.
Yeah. Well, I'm saying this. I mean, the reason I said that, the different prophetic journeys that God has sent you on, Mexico, Uganda, and even right now you're going down on probably a prophetic journey to Alabama, right, or something?
I am, yes. Going to Selma.
Yeah, and you went there a year ago. Was it the 50th anniversary, if I remember?
Yes, I was. But you have a great memory, David. I was.
Well, I remember.
Great stories to tell about that, too, but maybe some other time.
Yeah, we're running out of time here. But anyway, I wanted to say that the reason I was having you, I was sharing that, and a reason for that, and that is because God has so uniquely used you, positioned you, in how, I mean, he set the stage, you and connected me with Dr. Rivers, and then all the things prophetically that came out of that, many dreams and things you shared with me about Rwanda and in Burundi, and just all these things are just pointers to the way that God has used you. And all that said, it was very uncoincidental and very prophetic, I believe, 2 years ago that God sent you to the West Coast. And then out of the clear blue, I mean, calling forth the East to the West revival, as you said, the revolution. I mean, you know, that was a God deal. That was a prophetic act of obedience. And I honestly believe that is probably, you know, a part of what or why this has happened. And all that said is to encourage all of us that we're at a kairos time. Now, we're going to have Chuck sharing here in a little bit, and I'm going to share more about that word kairos, because it's at a point in time. But God uses his prophets, he uses his servants to accomplish his will. And Joyce, I just really believe God used you 2 years ago to set the stage for what's happening here on April 9th. Are you still there? Did we lose Joyce? Oh, I think we lost Joyce. And I was going to have her pray before she left. She's traveling. She's on the road, as we just were hearing. She's traveling to Alabama. And my greatest concern in doing the call with her traveling is that this might happen. We lost her. Anyway, Joyce, thank you. And I'm assuming that maybe you can hear me. We just lost connection there. But in any event, we thank Joyce. And if she does happen to call back in, connect here, well, I want to have her come on and just pray. But right now, we want to change gears here. And we're going to invite Chuck Witzel onto the call. Let me switch gears here. I'm going to turn away from the screen here a minute so I can operate my computer. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to call Mr. Witzel on Skype. And then what's going to happen is he's going to share with us the prophetic word that God gave him today. And it's really good. All righty. All right.
Yes.
Here you are, sir.
Yes, I am.
Okay. There's probably a good name for this headset twins here. Someday we're probably going to get some high technology and be able to move beyond some of the technology that we have right here and actually have like a production studio or something. But here we go here. Prophetic Insights with Chuck Witzel. You probably can't see that on your screen, because you're on another.
No,
yeah, I thought so. Anyway, here's what happened today, everybody. I was calling Chuck just to kind of get an update what's going on in his world, and he told me that he had just come from a prayer meeting, and God gave a pretty amazing prophetic word there, And Chuck, I'm going to probably comment here a little bit about a Kairos moment, but I'm going to let you go ahead and share what's on your heart, and then we can interact kind of as you're moving along here. So, but you know what? We didn't pray. I got so excited about having Joyce come on the call here, and I was going to have her close that segment with prayer. But I want to just jump in here with a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you for this time tonight. And we thank you, Father, for the word you gave us through Joyce. And I thank you, Father, for the knowing we're in a day and time, a Kairos time, an appointed time. And this call event on April 9th is just part of a much bigger picture of what you're doing. And so, Father, I pray that we have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying. And I pray, Father God, that everything and anything you would want us to know, you'd bring it forth, Father, even tonight and for the days and weeks to come. And that I pray, Lord God, for each person's courage to be obedient and to be willing to do whatever you might say, Father, in the name of Jesus. And I just know, Father, that you know, great things happen because of faith. And I thank you, Father, for faith in the body of Christ to step out of the boat and do the exploits you promised would happen to us through the prophet Daniel. So, Father, thank you now for this segment. And, Father, we commit it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, sir. I know you were already bathed in prayer, but just a little extra there. So tell us what happened today. Tell us about the surrounding of the event.
Well, basically, because of your ministry, Dave Martin Ministries, and what I have been doing for years, Kingdom World Changers, you know, over a period of this last few months, years, I guess, somehow or another, we got wed together. I don't even know how to explain that, but we're functioning together as a team and doing different things, but we also know that both of us have huge visions, and we have a lot of things that we believe God's going to work through both of us and collectively. Still don't know how that's all going to work together, but that's not our concern. God is working on it. And Cindy, who's part of the Kingdom World Changers, she's an intercessor, and she has a team, and a lot of the team is on here tonight. Rhonda, and let's see, Jackie, and others around the world around this team. So I told Cindy, because I had this feeling in my spirit that we need to get to the next level. We need to do it soon. And we need to how to get there. So I asked Cindy if she would help her team come together and we'd pray. So she said, well, let's do it at 1 o'clock to 1:30 every day after we get done praying for a week. We'll see where it goes. So anyway, that's what's happening. And as we were praying together, her team is prophetic intercessors. If you've never been involved with this, you'd have no clue that this stuff can even happen. Traveling in the heavenlies with Jesus, driving an iron chariot, you know, over the nations, and something like out of Steven Spielberg, but it's real. And so it's a whole different, well, Kingdom World Changers is a whole different thing. So it's if you're tired of religion, join the kingdom, come visit us. So anyway, as we're praying today, and of course the needs we have are great. We need, some of the things we're praying about is the resources we need, the finances, relationships, wisdom, revelation. And as most people know, our ministry is founded on repentance, holiness, intimacy with the Father, how to create an open heaven and hearing from God and interfacing with God on a consistent basis. So anyway, while we're praying, we're all getting stuff from the Lord, and I was writing all this stuff down, and the Lord was starting to talk to me about the when Samaria was being sieged by the I think it was Ben-Hadad, mm-hmm. and he says, go look that up. I want to show you something. So I pulled my Bible out, I flipped it open, and surprise, surprise, guess where it opened up to?
All by itself.
Right there at the sixth chapter of Second Kings. But here's what he was telling me, and I think it was so neat, because as I was sitting here, and Dave called this afternoon, and he said, what's going on, and how's your prayer thing? I just shared some things, so he thought it was something we should share. But here's the story, and most of us, or a lot of us, are familiar with this story, when Elijah was the prophet, and he was living in Samaria, and the king came and sieged the city of Samaria, and before long there was a famine going on, and they were under siege. And so here's some of the principles God was telling me. He said, I want you to look at this. He said, because a lot of my body right now, and you and Dave and other ministries around the world, are under siege right now.
What an encouraging word. Praise God. Bring on the catapults.
And so what happened is it got so bad that there was cannibalism going on, and they were eating unclean animals, and the people were starting to, it was really getting bad. So the word of the Lord came to Elisha, and the word of the Lord was this, that tomorrow, at this time, everything will be back to normal. And this siege was going on for an extremely long time, probably a year or more. I don't have the exact number of months, but they were ready to all die. And the word of the Lord came, and what I was talking to Dave about, what the Lord was sharing with me, is a lot of us have been waiting a long time. It seems like things get worse instead of better, and we wonder, even if we have the right vision, Father, is the vision you gave us, I mean, this for real? We don't have the resources, we don't have this, we don't have that, Lord. I have the vision, but that's all I have. Where are the resources? And when we were talking about this, you know, just outside the wall of Samaria, just a few hundred yards, was all the provision they needed to make things normal. Just 3-4 minutes walk, it was all there. And it's the same with us. Many of us on this call tonight are only minutes away, hours away, you know, from our provision in order for us to move forward. But we have to keep the vision. We have to keep our mindset. Because here's what happened when Elijah gave the word of the Lord, and God is speaking to a lot of us today with the word of the Lord. Here's what in verse 1 in chapter 7, here's what Elijah said. He said, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord says. About this time tomorrow, a seela of flour would sell for a shekel, 2 seelas of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. But then there was an officer who walked around with the king like a bodyguard for the king. He heard what he said, and he said, look, even if the Lord would open the floodgates of heaven, this could not happen. That's where we don't want to go. This is a word of encouragement for all of us who have been going through stuff after stuff after stuff, and it doesn't seem to get better, it gets worse. And provision is not years away. It's not our, it's just moments away. It's right around the corner, and we have to keep our eyes on the word of the Lord. And so what happened here is this guy that doubted the word died and never got to see the vision or the word of the Lord come to pass in his life because he doubted. Now, there was also some other people involved. There was four lepers, and also as I'm meditating, the Lord says, you know, a lot of times what God wants to do to us and through us and bring to us will come from people that we least expect it. These four lepers were outcasts, and yet God used them to go out to the enemy's camp and show, and it was found that it was, they're all gone. Then he went back and told people, they're all gone, come and get what you need. So he told me, he said, do not look to things in the natural where I will bring your resources, people, all the things you need, but keep an open mind and be sensitive to me. We must hear the word of the Lord if we're going to, you know, bring in and receive what God has for us. We've got to be very sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Also, the four lepers went out at night when everybody else was sleeping, and they were working unknown to all the people that were in a situation under siege. The lepers were out there doing their job, and even tonight and even today, as we're sitting here wondering, where in the world is all this stuff coming from? How come I'm stuck here? What about this? God is working in the dark. In our darkness, it looks like dark does because we can't see it. But God is working and putting this together, the resources and stuff we need. And also, another thing he pointed out to me, when the leopards came back and says, hey, everything you need is out here, basically. But the king did not just let everybody flow out of there. He checked it out first. So he sent five men out to make sure that it was the way it should be. So as we move forward and God's starting to open doors for us, what he told me is check everything out. Don't quickly just take off and run down a path this way and that way. It may not be God. This is why it's important to be able to hear the voice of God, be able to come to a place of rest in him, listen carefully, and not run after everything we think might be it, even though it looks like it, but check it out, rest in it, until we're convinced that this is the direction, this is what God wants us to do. So that was kind of the essence of what the Lord showed me.
Well, that was awesome. One of the things that so stood out to me as we were sharing here, I was driving and you were sharing, but that you made a comment, it's the season for the Josephs.
Yes.
Now, to tell people, you know, from your opinion, what is a Joseph? And when you said that, it resonated in my heart. This is the season. Now, let me before you go there, let me just add something here spiritually to this. In Greek, there's two basic words for time. Chronos is a chronological time. So essentially, in chronological time, you know, the beginning of the world, Adam and Eve time, goes back 6,000 years ago. So, you know, essentially, Adam and Eve happened 6,000 years ago. And then after 4,000 years, Jesus came at an appointed time. And that was determined by God before the foundation of the world. I mean, he knew what would happen. He knew about the fall. He knew all the things that would happen. But he already had a plan to restore what he knew would be lost through Jesus. In all of the Old Testament, like 800 different passages pointed to the appointed time of Jesus' first coming. And every one of those was fulfilled exactly at the appointed time. And when something is an appointed time, like the feast of God every year, like we're coming into this is a week of many feasts, of the, you know, the feast of the unleavened bread, the feast of the first fruits, which will be on Resurrection Sunday and Passover. And these are really significant feasts. And God has the Jews celebrate those feasts, for lack of a better word, religiously, judiciously, every year at an appointed time. It's kind of interesting. Speaking of appointed times, in Genesis, I think it's 11, verse 7, as I remember, but there it says that the ark, Noah's ark, came to rest on Mount Ararat the seventh month, and I think it was the seventh day. Why would something like that be in Scripture? But that was when the rainbow appeared, and it was a sign of new beginnings. Well, ironically, you see, God foreshadowed Resurrection Sunday. And in Jewish time, which starts, the new year starts in September, the resurrection happened literally the seventh month, and I think it's the seventh day. That's an appointed time. I mean, how interesting, you know, literally 2,000 or 3,000, four, almost 4,000, probably 3,000 years beforehand, God had this all worked out, that this appointed time. And I'm elaborating on this because he's coming back the second time at an appointed time. And in Timothy, it tells us that in the latter times, that there people would fall away from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons. Well, latter there in Greek, in 2 Timothy chapter 3:1, latter means the end of the end, and like we've been in the last days for a long time, but the latter there means the end of the end, latter times. Well, that word times, again, is the Greek word kairos, and it means an appointed time. Well, before the appointed time of Jesus' return, we're going to see every prophetic promise, every prophetic word that Jesus gave fulfilled. One of those prophetic words that he gave to us is John 14:12, that every sign, every wonder, every miracle that he did, we would do, and even greater. Well, I believe that's the season that we're coming into, to see the greatness of the demonstration of God beyond anything the world has ever seen. We also see from Proverbs 13:22, the wealth of the wicked is stored up for the righteous. And so that's going to happen. James, I think it's verse chapter 5, it says that in the last days that the wealth of the wicked is going to be turned over to the righteous, kind of paraphrasing that. But that's where we are. We're in a kairos time. And Joseph served at an appointed time, and that was an appointed time. And so with that foundation, Chuck, tell us again, or now, what, you know, what it means to be a Joseph ministry.
Well, the way I understand it is whenever we get a vision from the Lord or a calling or a purpose, and we know this is what God has called us to do, we basically have a Joseph ministry in that what we use as a Joseph model is this. Joseph got a vision when he was a young man. And he knew that God called him to greatness, to be a ruler. And he told his brothers and father about it, which got him into trouble. Your vision will probably get you into a lot of trouble. That's why you know it might, one of the reasons you might know it's from the Lord. Because you will be tested. It's Jesus, after he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, it said, and then Jesus led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. And that's the same thing would happen to Joseph. He got a vision. He got thrown in a pit. He ended up shortly in jail in Egypt. He spent probably close to 15 years in jail before he ascended to the throne. Now, a lot of things happened there. But the principles are this. You get a vision. You are tested to see. And the testing does not, God knows what's in our heart. But it's really to prepare us. Joseph needed to learn the language over there in Egypt. So he spent all that time learning. He needed to know a lot of other things. And so when you're a Joseph ministry, in my estimation, if you got a feeling that God has called you to do something, things are going to happen. Don't expect everything to be really, really good. It doesn't happen even without a vision. But when you get a vision, God wants to prepare so we can be successful in it. So, and today, there's a lot of people out there that have been tried and tested for 10, 15, even 20 years or more. And God is getting ready to release you into your ministry, into your calling, into a provision, into another realm that you, at one time, maybe you thought you were supposed to be in because of life and other things have dealt you such a blow that you kind of, well, I'll just hang on, you know, instead of getting revved up and say, no, I refuse to accept second place. I refuse to allow my destiny to be unfulfilled. I refuse, and we get mad, and we get excited, and we get tested, but we just stay steadfast on it like Jesus did. Even though he was tempted for 40 days, he knew where he was going, and he got there. It was, as Dave said, it was a kairos moment for him. There's many, many Josephs on this call tonight that you have been called. You've been through stuff, and you say, well, maybe because of all the junk in my life, I'm disqualified. Good news, you're not disqualified. The only person that can disqualify is you, is yourself. Jesus will not, because he gave it to you. The devil cannot unless you let him. So there's no disqualifiers on this call tonight. None, zero. Make a circle with your finger and your thumb. It's zero. People are disqualified tonight from your calling and vision. All you have to do is get back on that horse again and tighten up the cinch and start riding that horse into your vision, what God is, and say, you refuse to let the devil steal your destiny from you. And so this is what a Joseph is. Joseph are tested. They a lot of stuff happens to them. But I just want to encourage you tonight. I believe everybody on this call is a Joseph, because the only people come on this call are people that really are a step above. They have a heart for God. You wouldn't be here
the remnant.
On a Tuesday night. You were not called of God, and you're pushing in, you're pressing in. You want more. God will meet each one of us where we're at, because every one of us on this call is a Joseph, because you're here because you think there's more. And I'm telling you tonight, there is more.
Amen. And not only that there is more, but it's time. And that's what so spoke to me. And there's just no coincidences in God. This April 9th date is just a divine, that's a kairos moment. And so at the same time this is happening, I mean, I don't consider myself a prophet. I consider myself prophetic, but not a prophet. But I have known, I've been sensing it since last fall, that we're at a point of wealth transfer, in seeing the wealth of the wicked come into the kingdom of God. And to me, I mean, one of the signs of a Joseph, or to me, one aspect of being a Joseph beyond what Chuck said, is somebody that is going to be seeing money go through their hands to fund the kingdom. Now, there are some people on this call here tonight that God has been positioning you and preparing you to handle billions, maybe even trillions of dollars. And this is the season, this is the time, it will happen. Be encouraged, as Chuck said. Your vision, you have known in your heart, you were called to be a steward, to be in a ministry of giving, to fund ministries, to see the churches paid off, to see, you know, ministry supported in abundance, to do all that they're called to do. Well, this is your season. This is the time, I believe, as I was hearing Chuck say this today, my spirit man just resonated. That we're so close. You know, the enemy is leaving the goods. The wealth of the wicked is just outside the wall. And as Chuck said in the story there, it's only minutes away. You know, but we're right there. I chuckled to myself because of what Joel Guy heard about time and how a day is as 1,000 years. Well, a minute, what's that? A couple decades. But anyway, the provision of God is now. Now, here's something I want to really instill to every one of you, that you don't have to be in business to handle great sums of money. You don't have to have a big stock portfolio to watch God turn it around. You have a desire to handle money for the kingdom of God. Here's what's important, is what's in your heart. Because God knows if he can get it through you, he'll get it to you. As I teach business leaders around the world this concept and what we call business breakthrough, one of the foundation principles I teach is having a heart to give. Many people would say, well, if I had more money, I would give more. Well, see, the truth is God knows your heart. He knows what happens to so many people is when they receive money, it becomes a curse to them. It becomes their God. And then, you know, they forget how they got to their to that place. The Bible is full of those stories of people that God raised up to greatness, and then they forgot their roots, where they came from, and the vision that God had for them. And God has a vision for each and every one of us to be great in the kingdom of God in different ways. And your greatness might be great. Your calling might be to be the greatest mom or the greatest wife, to support a husband. I feel like my wife, as much as she has, you know, a ministry of her own, one of her major aspects of her calling is supporting me to do what God's given me to do around the world. I couldn't do what I did unless I had a wife that was supportive and encouraging and believing and releasing me. So, you know, think of yourself that same way. You know, you don't have to be the person on the front line. The supply line is just as important. And in Joseph, what Joseph did literally is he controlled all of the wealth of the known world. He managed it. And that's what God's doing right now. I believe he's raising up people that are going to manage his kingdom, the great resources. I believe God's raising up not just a new government per se, but his kingdom, his government is being established right now here on planet Earth. And I believe God is speaking to each and every one of us that even as it says in Romans 5:17, it says by the offense of one, death reigned. That's Adam's fall. By the offensive one, death reigned. Much more, they which receive of the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, that's the ability to stand in the presence of God as if sin never existed. And that's what Chuck was alluding to here. You know, it doesn't matter, you know, how much you have failed, how much you've messed up, how much you've disappointed God. God still has his hand on you. His love is there for you. And he has a plan for you to rule and reign. Going back to the plan of Adam, he created man to have dominion on planet Earth. Well, Jesus came to restore that which was lost. And again, Romans 5:17, by the offensive one death reigned, much more they which receive of the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life. That word reign means to function as a sovereign. It means to be a ruler. It means to be in authority. And that's what I'm sensing God right now is saying to us. And that's what I heard between the lines and what Chuck said today that so excited me. This is the moment. This is the time. This is what we have been believing for. This is what we've been tested for, proven for, is to manage the world's wealth and world's resources and to see the kingdom of God established here on planet Earth. And, you know, yeah, there's going to probably be some fallout here and there and wickedness, but you know what? Where darkness is, light shines that much brighter, and you are the light of the world, and God's raising you up now to shine and to illumine, to be illuminated with his glory. Hallelujah. Well, Chuck, hey, I'm preaching myself happy. What do you think about all that?
I say amen and amen. I think I got saved again tonight after that.
Well, there you go. How about that?
One of the things that I say constantly to myself, and we never rise above our confession. Whatever our confession is, that's our ceiling. If you say, well, it's not going to work for me, that's your ceiling.
Yeah.
But what I want to encourage you to do tonight, because first of all, as I mentioned before, your destiny will never be stopped by God, because he's got everybody encouraging us, all the saints before us are up there cheering us on. Devil can't unless we agree with him, so it's all up to us. Decide, sit down and look at what God has called you to do. Write it down, and write it up in the form of confession, I will. And then put it on the mirror. I got stuff all over my mirrors. Anybody that's been in my house, I got stuff on every mirror. You can hardly see the shape. But because I want that ever before me, my confession, and I'm never going to give up in the night season. Now, also, we write contracts with our words. If you want to buy a house today, you got to go down there, you got to sign a contract, and they stamp it, and they look it all over. But in the spirit realm, we write contracts with our words. What kind of contracts have we written the last some contracts will release the enemy to come against us and do his work. Some contracts will release angels to do work for us. So look at your contracts or your words and see who's going to work for you and or me. And I'm very cognizant of that because I know this. And you live long enough, you realize this stuff happens. And so I want my angels to go to work. I want my angels working for me. So when I get up in the morning, my confession, the other day the Lord was speaking to me, and he says, son, what you need, the Bible is really, you know, a compilation, and it, if you summed up maybe in kind of roughly into three words, that's health, wealth, and wisdom. He says, I can supply two of them. You have to supply the other one. Guess which one I have to supply? I've got to take care of my body. But the wisdom and the wealth, God will supply. We just have to get our confession lined up with the will of God, what the Bible says, start confessing it, and take the vision we have. Take those things that it may be 30 years ago that you kind of gave up on. It could be 20 years, 10. Maybe you're still driven along here. As David said, this is a kairos moment. When you speak into a kairos moment, guess what? Stuff happens.
Yep.
And so get ready for stuff to happen. And you might even want to put something in the mirror like, today, stuff happens.
Yeah, that works.
Sticking on your mirror.
Hallelujah.
I am, with what the Lord showed me today, because we're going to be praying all week for for your ministry, and which means everybody on the call tonight are going to get be prayed for. Gets everybody in coming to our Sunday mornings, everybody on the call, on the intercession call. So everybody is covered here in intercession this week. And because it's these two ministries being wed together, and I don't know how it even happened or how what's happening. So it doesn't make any difference. But I'm telling you, do not miss this Kairos moment.
Amen.
There's people on the call today that a year from today, you look back and says, I cannot believe it. I had a mindset change, and now my world has changed.
Yep. That works. You know, something God told me many years ago, he said, the only limitation you will ever have is the one you define.
Amen.
So whatever you say is impossible will be, whatever you say you can't do and you won't do. But the Word of God doesn't agree with that. The Word of God says, Jesus said in Mark 9:23, if you can believe, all things are possible. The Bible says nothing is impossible to him who believes. So know you're a world changer. Know that even as you're agreeing and partnering with this ministry, I like one of our partners said, David, every dollar I sow, I see that dollar as another soul saved in your vision for 100 million. So praise God. And see that every time you sow a dollar, it's another soul saved. Praise God. So, you want to invest in your kingdom account because, you can't take this world with you, but you can send it ahead. Amen. But you need to have a vision and you need to believe that you serve a God that's able to do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all you could ever ask, think, or imagine. And what's so exciting to me is now, it's a now deal. It's something, that many of us, myself, we're talking 37 years of preparing for. In 1979, God gave me the very first word of prophecy. He said to me, David, I'm going to use you to reach the most wealthy people in the world. And at that time, I was working for a company, and so I started my background being marketing. I started developing a marketing plan, never realizing God's ways are quite different. But here we are, 37 years later, and now I can actually see how God has positioned me to do what He told me 37 years ago. Well, for you too. God's given you many different prophetic words over the course of time. He's given you dreams. He's given you inspirations. Know that even though some of you have lost hope and hope deferred makes the heart sick, this is the day of restoration. This is the day God wants to restore your hope, wants to restore your dream, wants to restore your vision, because it is a now time. No, for you, it is a now time. It's time for you. And as I'm saying this, I'm reminded of a man that prophesied over me, Bob Trench from South Africa, is standing next to Dima Shikari, and I was at a meeting, and they called me out and said to me, now is the time to get out from underneath the shade tree and go do the exploits God's called you to do. Well, I give you that same word that was given to me 35 years ago, 34 years ago, something like that. Now is the time to get out from underneath the shade tree and go do the exploits God has given to you to do. But know this. God is positioned you and positioned the world for such a time as this, even as it says in Isaiah 60, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the brightness of the world is going to be drawn to your brightness, that the wealth of the wicked is going to come to you. And there's a reason for that. Just like Joseph, he had a purpose in God to provide for the kingdom, and God is going to use you in that same way. And the more you can hook up with that, the more you can believe that you're a world changer and you're somebody that makes a difference in the kingdom of God, and your heart is given to His plan and His purpose, God's going to use you mightily for His glory. Amen. Well, praise God. Well, Chuck, we hit the 1 hour mark here, actually a few minutes over. I've been preaching here. Why don't you close us with a word of prayer? And
could I share just a 2-second testimony here?
Because
I think it's important. I was a short time ago. I was down at a meeting, and a friend of mine came up and said, "Hey, I don't know if you know, but my wife has got I don't stage 3-4 cancer of the breast." And I said, "No, I didn't hear about that." And so he said, "Would you pray for her?" And I said, "Absolutely." So I prayed for her. It's been a year and a half, I guess. I prayed for her, but in the process of praying, the Lord says, "Tell her this." She said, "Pat, how long do you want to live? Because the devil cannot take your life, and I won't. You tell me how long you want to live, and I'll get you there." And so I said, "Wow, what a revelation." I was more excited than she was, I think. God won't. The devil can't. It's up to us.
Yeah.
Our confession. So I just encourage everybody tonight, realize that the devil cannot take your vision. I don't care how long, what you've done with it. He cannot take it. God won't. But we have to come into agreement with God and our vision and start broadcasting it verbally.
Yeah. And that Pat's from Rockford, right?
Yeah. Pat Dolly.
Yeah, I know who she is, and she's doing well.
Oh, yeah, she is.
Yeah.
Great.
Hallelujah. All righty. Well, everybody, again, thank you for the privilege you've given to us tonight to speak into your life. And thank you again for your prayers. And we're going to be praying for you, even as Chuck said. And we thank you for whatever you do to help support the work of the ministry. And if God speaks to your heart even right now, go to the website. You can do that and make a contribution there. And I'll tell you what, I'm gonna jump in with a promotion right here. There is a CD series. There's only 2 CDs in the series. A set more than a series. But it's one of the greatest, greatest, greatest revelations God's ever given to me. And it's I Am Anointed. It is so life-changing. And it's a story about Rodney Clark and how Rodney Clark, when he was only a sophomore in high school, he was coached by Billy Brim, Chip Brim's son. And what Chip did is he told Rodney, he said, "Rodney, here's the deal. You want to confess every day that you're anointed to play basketball. And number 2, that you're anointed to play basketball at a level the world is not familiar. And number 3, you're anointed to play basketball in a world the world's not familiar for the glory of God." Now, here's what's incredible. Rodney was short. Rodney was white. And Rodney couldn't jump. Coming from a small high school, Verdigris, which is right outside of Tulsa, Oklahoma. Actually, my son played basketball in his gym. But Rodney, in the natural, had no natural thing going for him. Again, white, can't jump, and small school. But he every day he started confessing, "I'm anointed to play basketball at a level the world's not familiar for the glory of God." And to tell you a long story short, by the time he was a senior in high school, he broke shooting records in Oklahoma, and every college in America was trying to recruit him, and everyone came to Tulsa trying to recruit him, saying, "There's something different about this man." Well, it was the anointing. And this same concept was brought to Hollywood. The same concept was brought to different levels of people in business. And every person that has applied this, including myself, has seen an incredible, incredible difference. Now, that CD series, I promise you, if you get it, you'll be greatly blessed with it. I have people tell me they play it over and over and over again. Matter of fact, when I delivered that message the first time in Gage, Oklahoma, about 3 years ago, the pastor took the message, what I taught, and shared it with one of his students that was in high school, senior in high school. And I got this revelation exactly like 4 years ago in April. And she was a senior in high school. And decided as a senior, she didn't have any letter for her jacket. She wanted to go for a letter. And the coach said, "Well, you know, the one sport that's left here is track. Why don't you go out for track? So she's in track. The coach said, I think, and based on your physique, you might do well at pole vault. Now, we're talking about April. This revelation came in April. And so he took this to this girl and said, here's what you want to do. You want to confess every day that you're anointed to pole vault at a level the world's not familiar for the glory of God. This is hard to believe, but this is the truth. This gal came from a town so small, they didn't even have their own high school. She went to a neighboring town, Woodward, Oklahoma, another small town in Oklahoma. But within weeks of getting this concept into her heart and believing it, she broke the state record for pole vaulting. Never pole vaulted in her life. But the truth is, it's not a magic formula. It's a reality of applying the truth and the principles of God's word, that what you do it for the glory of God. You confess it, you believe it, and you do it with a purpose, knowing that God anointed you for this purpose. So know this, you're anointed to make money at a level the world's not familiar for the glory of God. You're anointed to be a Joseph at a level the world's not familiar for the glory of God. I could actually take you across my desk here, pointing up at here in my cabinet, but there is a rock up there engraved, and it's about this big, and it says, I am anointed to teach and to demonstrate the word of God at a level the world's not familiar for the glory of God. I'm telling you, it works. I believe it. I got it in granite, as it would be. But here's the point. Any one of you that make a donation and do it tonight or do it this week, and there on your donation, write, I am anointed, or make a notion, and then just make a memo, I'm anointed. And what I'll do with any donation given this week, I'll mail you that CD series, two CDs, as a gift for helping us to do the work of the ministry. So I don't know that I've ever done that before on a Tuesday night in 4 years, but just God wants you to have that CD series, whether you get it by a donation or you can buy it in a library as well. But in any event here, Chuck, why don't you pray a good night prayer for us here? And again, everybody, thank you so much for your partnership in the ministry.
Father, what a wonderful time to be with your saints tonight.
Yes.
Father, I feel that I'm speaking to the greatest audience. Mm. There is going to be more kingdom things happen in this group of people on this call and listen to the tape later on. There'd be more people that's lives are going to be changed tonight than I've ever spoken to before. And so, Father, I come into agreement with your will for everybody's purpose and calling in their life. I
yes.
come into agreement with the destiny of everybody. Father, I ask you tonight that you release the Holy Spirit to go out and during the night season, start giving people dreams in the night season about their vision. Father, in during the daytime, when they go somewhere, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, Father, let the body of Christ just work through words of knowledge, words of wisdom. I pray that when they're driving along, something will come on the, just a signpost will say, that's what God's told me to do. And just confirm all those things again and again and again. Then I pray, Father, and I ask the Holy Spirit that you would then, all of us, myself included, is, Lord, that you would constantly just encourage me with downloads of wisdom and downloads of information, and send people in my life, Father, to encourage me to keep going and not settle for anything less than the fullness of my calling, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Woo! And amen.
Praise God, everybody. And if that didn't get you burning, I'm not sure what will, but thank you again. And till next Tuesday night, be blessed. Have a great, glorious week. And next week, I'm going to be doing the message, I think, anyway, that I planned for tonight. Great message on being steadfast, getting your eyes fixed on Jesus. Going to be sharing a testimony of Peter Daniels, how somebody that was a nobody literally couldn't read, couldn't write, couldn't even speak at the age of 28 in 1956, has become one of the most successful people in the world. And I'm going to share his testimony, how he became that, and insight, tremendous revelation from the Word of God. And that was my plan for tonight, because the key for him was Jesus had his face set like flint for Jerusalem, which was fulfilled 2,000 years ago when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, Palm Sunday, Passover week, and literally he steadfastly, that's the stainrinzo is the Greek word there, he had his face set like flint, fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 50. Anyway, going to be a great week next week. See you next week. Y'all have a great blessed week, and we're going to turn off all the microphones here and they give you a chance to say good night one to another, and God bless.
Good night.
I tell you what, if that didn't get your motor going, I'm not sure what will. I tell you what, we are in this incredible time in history, and to know how special it is that God called you, called me to be a part of this move of God that's going to literally, I think, usher in the return of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, real quickly here in closing, first off, let me say thank you so very much for the privilege you give me of speaking into your life, and I just really appreciate that, and I feel very honored with that. And I thought you might like to see what I talked about in the rock that I had. Actually, it was a gift to me. It was a birthday gift from my sister, but I mentioned it in the last part of the session here, the show, and so I thought you might like to see that. It's heavy. I pulled it down from my bookcase. It's literally 4.5 pounds. But David, let's see if we can zoom in on this. That's it. I'm anointed to teach and to demonstrate the supernatural at a level the world is not familiar with or for the glory of God.
Woo!
I tell you what, is that not exciting? Praise God. All righty. Well, again, thank you for the privilege you've given me here, speaking into your life. What a great day. And again, just as a reminder, if you would be so kind to support us, especially right now, we'd appreciate that, help in the ministry. And with any donation, make mention of the series. I called it in the teaching, I'm Anointed. But in reality, the name of the series is The Revelation of the Operation of the Anointing. I promise you, you're going to love it. It's one of those kind of messages you play over and over and over again. So again, just make a donation and make a note. I'm Anointed, free gift, and we'll give that to you, get that to you. Absolutely no charge, and just as a thank you for your support of the ministry. So until next time, next Tuesday, we look forward to you having a great, glorious week. And if you have any prayer requests or anything we can help you with, please feel free to contact us at the ministry. You can go to the ministry website at davemartinministries.com or livingsupernaturally.com, or you can call us at 800-543-PRAY. That's 7729. And again, you can make a donation by going online or just call the office, and we can help you over the phone as well with MasterCard, Visa, or Discover. And again, thank you so much for the opportunity here of speaking into your life. God bless. Have a great day.